Tortorella, interesting comments there, saying he thought Game 6 against the Bruins was the Blue Jackets' best game of the series. Agree or disagree?
I don't think it was. I mean, they won two games in the series, so, I mean, you'd have to look at those, and I think there was even games that they lost that they maybe played better in. But that's, you know, listen, he's looking at it more closely than me. Maybe he goes back and looks at the tape. There's things that he's looking to accomplish in those games. Maybe he felt they accomplished those things, but to me, they lost 3-0, and they didn't score on the power play. I don't know how that's your best game, but...
Okay, fair enough.
My 2 cents. I could be dead wrong.
You're entitled to your 2 cents.
Thank you. That's why
you're here.
That's about all I ever get.
I've asked this question many times, but now that it is over, and lots I'll ask you because we talked about this on the show yesterday, did the means justify what we now know as the ends, quote unquote, for the Columbus Blue Jackets? Your thoughts based on the deadline acquisitions?
I think you really have to do a deep dive and go through everything. Obviously, in terms of short term, and being the next event for the Columbus Blue Jackets to draft this summer, they've got a 3rd and a 7th round pick. That's not good. It's not going to get much better next year. But I like the fact that this hockey club, John Tortorella and Jarmo Kekäläinen, and Billy Zito for that matter, they had the gall to jump into this thing, the gusto, so to speak, to make a really difficult call, something we don't see that often in this league, and I commend them for it. They still have a very good hockey team, even if they didn't get anybody back, and I believe they certainly have a good chance to bring back Duchesne, Dzingel as well. Not so certain on Bobrovsky and Panarin, but it doesn't matter for me because it's the rest of the players, the core that they have. The next few years, they'll spend a lot of time trying to figure out how they kind of re-energize their drafts, but it's the guys that they have already there that will be, allow them to be able to do that. And I think Jarmo Kekäläinen knew that full well. You got Jones and Werenski still there. Yeah. You got other young guys like Texte, who I was really impressed with. Obviously, Pierre-Luc Dubois. Veterans are still coming back. Jenner, Foligno, Atkinson, Dubinsky, Wennberg.
Anderson.
Yeah. It's not like they have no hockey team.
No, they have a lot of good players there.
Yeah, the fact of the matter is now that clubs, I think you're going to see it even more in the future, are going to gyrate up and down. And you're going to see teams like Dallas that made a couple of key moves right at the deadline.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden it changed their fortunes. Just adding a Zuccarello and a Ben Lovejoy to the mix, we're able to elevate them to almost make it to the 3rd round. And I think that's the wave of the future. So I'm not as hard. We don't know who's not coming back for sure yet anyhow, so it's early to judge. But assuming nobody did, I still think it's fine.
And there's a lot of free agents out there that Columbus could go for, but this is a look at theirs. Obviously widely reported all season long. I mean, this isn't news to anybody.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't realize, I've said it many times in the show, I give Jarmo a lot of credit for going out and kind of doubling down on his group, because every market, every team, there's different circumstances, you're at different stages along the way. The Jackets in their near 20 years right of existence, they had never been out of the first round of the postseason. You need to generate some excitement in your market. Like Lott says, they have some really good players there. They got two guys on the back end, and Jones and Werenski, who's really good. I mean, we could argue
top-notch.
Yeah, we could argue whether or not they should have traded those guys last summer.
Right.
I mean, I think that's a better argument to have.
A different
debate entirely. But once you made the decision that you were going forward with those guys, I don't think selling them at 10 cents on the dollar at the deadline was going to be helpful. I don't know what market there was for Bobrovsky at all as a goalie, and certainly for Panarin, you wouldn't got near the kind of return that you would have got. Now, when you look at a board here of what they gave up, I mean, yeah, it's substantial when you look at, you know, the numbers. But again, now, let's not look at it without looking at the years, right? Because they gave up the conditional first round of this year, which is going to be, what, a 20 to 31 pick in the draft. You know, they've got good young players there, so they can afford to give that up. They're only going to have a 3rd and 7th year this year, so that's not great for them. But they didn't, in these trades, give up a lot of high-end prospects. They gave up middling prospects. 2020, they'll be without the first rounder if they re-sign Matt Duchesne. So think about this. If you re-sign Matt Duchesne, you're trading him for a first round pick, which again, could be a back end first round pick. Maybe not a bad exchange. You have those second rounders in there. Those are currency. You might be able to get those back over time as things unfold. So for me, and I've said it all along, I just think that Jarmo did the best. I was really impressed with what he did at the deadline. It didn't work out at the end. They lose to Boston in the 2nd round. But the good news for the Bruins is the teams that beat the Blue Jackets, have gone on to win the Cup in each of the last 2 years.
Yeah.
So, you know, the Blue Jackets, it's unfortunate they run into some good teams, and maybe the Bruins will win the Cup this year. We will see. But I think given the circumstances of going into the year with these players, I think they made a right move.
And there's something to be said for Jarmo Kekäläinen having to play a hand, so to speak, that everybody knew what was in it. Everybody knew Jarmo Kekäläinen's situation, right? So that's a difficult hand to play to, you know, keep the metaphor going.
No, I talked to him after the trade deadline at the GM meeting, and we had a little bit of a chat down there by the water at Boca Raton. And, like, you know,
Sounds terrible.
And I was asking, it was awful. It was awful. That tiki bar is a terrible place to be. But the interesting thing was he really confirmed what I already knew, was that the offers for Panarin in particular were not very good. It was maybe a first-round pick. And usually the teams that want Panarin, they're competing for a playoff. So they're giving you, the 28th overall first, pick in the first round, which is nice to have, but not near enough for a player like Panarin. Sure. And maybe you pick a prospect off this list of our B prospects and maybe another pick down the road. It's just not enough to get for Panarin. If you're a Columbus Blue Jackets fan, you see that deal come down the pike. You're like, why are we even here?
Yeah.
So for me, I think, again, the decision to keep them last summer is where you could have the discussion about what they decided to do. But once they went forward, I think they really tried to make a push. They still have really good players there, and they have a chance. If these guys all leave, they'll have a lot of money to spend, and maybe they'll add some additional players.
And it's a good point, right? Because people focus so much on those two specifically, Bob and Panarin. But to your point, Lots, that you made earlier, they do have a nice young core still in play.
Yeah. They still got a good hockey team, and they fully knew that when they made all these decisions. And where he talked about Texier, we like him. Elvis is, in my opinion,
Elvis,
the guy
coming to the building.
He's the guy ready to step in and play goal next year at the National Hockey League level. He's been a pro over in Switzerland for 4 or 5 years now in the top league. So I just I don't see him in that bad a spot, personally. Yeah. I really don't. And that's the way the league is going. It really is, Ege. Now, the moral of the story might have been, yes, you should trade those players earlier.
Yeah.
Because once you go buy that, you're not going to get full value.
Absolutely.
It's funny because when you look at the return of some other guys that maybe weren't considered as high a level as them, it was pretty good.
Yeah.
But that's the top of the heap of what you get in today's world.
But those are teams maybe that knew they were out of it, right? They're trading those guys off. So they ended up doing pretty good, but they were in a different place than where the Blue Jackets are, which is trying to compete and contend and move forward in the playoffs. So every situation is different.
High-end guys, though, I'll tell you this. It's going to be the prices are so low because it's so hard for teams to fit them in that it's just not as attractive as you may think.
Yeah.
Like, even when you think about Mark Stone and what he went for, yes, there was a really good prospect in there, but it's not necessarily life-changing.
Yeah. And no matter how you look at it, it just was not meant to be for the Columbus Blue Jackets.